Our first panel is Human Rights, Civil Liberties, and Social Movements in Armenia. I will call first the moderator, Antranig, Executive Director of the Tufenkian Foundation, to the podium. And to follow him, Edik, Editor-in-Chief, Hetq Investigative Journalist Online, Sara, Anjargolian, Attorney and Documentarian, and Ursula Kazaryan, President and Founder, Armenian Environmental Network. Okay, Andranik.
Okay, I want to first of all thank the ABA for setting up this panel. And more broadly, I would like to commend the Armenian Bar Association for a course of activity in recent years that has become noticeable to us throughout the country. That is not simply contenting itself with being a professional or networking association, but being an association that really digs in and grapples with current affairs in the Armenian world. And as such, the ABA really is playing a valuable role, giving a valuable service to our community in addressing a whole range of issues and in a proactive way. So I thank you for that. Okay, Edmund Minassian has already introduced the panel's title. The subtitle that Sara Anjargolian circulated is Everything You Ever Wanted to Know About Social Movements in Armenia, But We're Afraid to Ask. So here we are, this is the time to ask. And I'm very happy that we have a rich lineup today featuring Sara Anjargolian, who is an accomplished photojournalist and documentarian, as well as an attorney, environmentalist Ursula Kazaryan, and noted journalist Edik Baghdasaryan. I expect today that we'll cover quite a bit of ground, hopefully through the presentations, as well as through your questions during the ensuing Q&A. Let me just begin with a few words of introduction and then we'll pass the baton. This for me is a very interesting subject, particularly when viewed broadly. If you look over the last 20, 25 years, Armenian activism has sort of gone through an interesting sinusoidal pattern, if you will. Now, most of us know that the pathway to Armenia's independence began in the mid-1980s, most notably in 1988, when Armenians took to the streets by the thousands and eventually close to 1 million, demanding the right of Nagorno-Karabakh to self-determination, specifically the Armenian population of Nagorno-Karabakh to secede from Azerbaijan and reunify with Armenia. There was a ferment of popular movement at the grassroots level in the late 80s, early 90s, culminating, of course, with the demise of the Soviet Union and the independence of Armenia and the other former Soviet republics. But that ferment did not last, and it did not develop organizational roots. And what happened as a result is that activism as such really went through a long stagnation period in the post-independence era. I would say throughout the 90s into the 2000s, the political reflexes of Armenians in Armenia, and not just the reflexes of the politicians, the reflexes of people at the grassroots level, were still heavily Soviet. The culture had been shaped by Stalinism, and that culture was very slow to fall away, very slow to shed. People looked up to the government, to the authorities, as the source of all ill and the source of all possible remedy. The idea of getting organized at the grassroots level around issues of environment, around women's issues, around a whole host of other issues, that culture really did not exist. Basically, it was an all or nothing environment. People thought, we need to change the authorities, we need to kick out the bums and bring in fair-minded people committed to justice and the rule of law. Well, that kind of all-or-nothing struggle rarely works. Usually, freedom struggles are cumulative. They build up from the grassroots level, demanding more and more reform, more and more change that sometimes leads to substantial reform, in some cases, regime change. Well, that time really was not ripe in the 90s. I would say even into the mid-2000s. It's hard to pinpoint exactly when, maybe 5, maybe 10 years ago, Armenia's social movement landscape began to take form, began to take shape. Again, there's no particular moment when it happened, but there were little social struggles that began to pop up. You saw the emergence of consumer rights unions that began to struggle against economic forces that did not label, did not provide health and safety for products that people were eating or breathing. So you had consumer rights unions, you had environmental groups, often makeshift groups, popping up and contesting power. For example, in Yerevan, where Yerevan had once been a city of parks, those parks one by one began to vanish in the face of rampant consumerization, popping up of cafes, jazz bars, often set up illegally through insider influence with the mayor of Yerevan. And environmentalists, along with others, put their foot down and at times won small victories, stopping rampant development and often illegal privatization of Armenia's green spaces. And you've also seen fledgling movements revolving around women's issues. I think, for example, last year when the Coalition to Prevent Violence Against Women actively worked to ensure that the legal system did what it was supposed to do. When Zarui Petrosyan's killer, Zarui Petrosyan was a young wife and mother who was kicked down a flight of stairs by her husband. Her husband was indicted and went through a long trial, and the Women's Coalition was one of those groups that constantly beamed a spotlight on this case and prevented it from going into the back rooms where some sort of deal, some sort of bargain could have been made to let this guy off. Point being that proto-social movements are beginning to emerge in Armenia today. I don't think they're full-fledged social movements with ideologies, organizational apparatus. Rather, there seem to be makeshift groups of activists that are getting more and more organized around grassroots issues. And I view this as tremendously encouraging because I think the view of Armenia as a basket case or as a hopeless case, that's passé. Armenia really is fertile ground for making changes towards social justice, where reform is not simply tried from within by a few well-meaning parliamentarians, but is actually tried at the grassroots level where people contest power wherever it manifests itself and demand concessions from the authorities and from the ruling elites. So today our speakers will address some of these issues. Now, I'm very happy that we've got three qualified speakers that can talk about activism in three or more areas, really. Environmental activism, and activism around women's rights, activism in freeing up the media landscape. We've got someone here, Edik, who many of you know is being honored with the ABA's Hrantink Award for being one of the courageous investigative journalists who pushed the envelope starting 5, 10, 15 years ago, when investigative journalism really didn't exist in Armenia. The idea of actually promoting a fourth estate that was going to beam a critical spotlight on Armenia's power moguls, really, with that whole effort was spearheaded by Edik and a few others. So really, I feel very fortunate that we have a panel like this today, and I would like to invite our panelists up so we can get going. So ground rules for today. Each presentation will be approximately 20 minutes. I will try to be strict within reason. Following the presentations, I expect we'll have a half hour, 45 minutes for Q&A involving your participation. So I look forward to having you join in on the discussion. Let me begin by introducing our first speaker, who's Ursula Kazaryan. I'm not going to give lengthy bios because you have them in your program booklets. So let me just give an abridged bio and then we'll jump into it. Ursula holds multiple degrees dealing with international relations, law, as well as environmental issues. She is founder of the Armenian Environmental Network, the AEN, which is based in Washington, D.C., with the aim of bridging information flows and activities between activists in Armenia and diaspora. The AEN already has a team working in Armenia, and I look forward to learning much more about them. So Ursula, take it away.
First of all, I just want to thank the Armenian Bar Association for having me here today on this panel. I've been working on environmental issues in Armenia for some years now, and it really is just so wonderful that now these issues are coming to light in the framework of social justice and other human rights issues. So I'm really thrilled to be here. Thank you. I think that the best way to open up this topic, although we will be talking about the Armenian context, is to give a backdrop as to why environment is so important to development, regardless of the country that we're talking about. So I want to start off with discussing, you know, the history of environment in the context of development, overall development. And these are some of my vacation photos, so you get to see this. a few different places. The way we use environment and have used environment utilize resources throughout the years. Sustenance, you can see some Panamanian fisher boys, I wouldn't say fishermen, young boys, fishing in mangroves. Shelter, this is a cave in Easter Island, and trade routes. So looking at London, many of the largest cities where we were able to grow our populations were based on the fact that we were able to utilize environmental and natural resources, such as rivers, such as tributaries, for economic growth and gain. And really, it's been about the past 100 years where environmental issues have really taken a forefront in international conventions and agreements. Especially the second half of the 20th century, and really culminating in this concept of sustainable development, which most of you have probably heard of at this point. The standard definition for sustainable development came out just before the Rio Summit in 92, so this was out in 87, and it was intentionally broad, saying sustainable development is development that meets the needs of the present without compromising the ability of future generations to meet their own needs. And what does that mean? How do we achieve that when we're trying to look at a specific project or a specific country, different levels of scope? There are three factors we look at to achieve sustainability. Those are environmental, economic, and social factors. If we take all three into account on an equal footing, we can ensure that we're achieving a result that is fair, viable, and livable. If we don't take all three into account, you can kind of see through this diagram, you may be getting something that's pretty good, but you're not taking into account the entirety. And we'll get into what that means in the Armenian context. And within the environmental movement, once you say, okay, we want to be sustainable, well, you know, how do we achieve this? There are two main schools of thought in the environmentalists. The first are preservationists, the second are conservationists. So it's important to understand the distinction. The first is preservation, or maintaining the natural state of an ecosystem for its intrinsic value. Again, vacation photos. So you can see that these have not really been disturbed. And some people would look at this as untapped potential. And some people would look at this and say, you know, we're preserving this nature because it deserves to be preserved, whether it's because of an endangered species, because maybe downriver something is being used, like drinking water, so you want to preserve that resource upriver. There are many different reasons to preserve something for its intrinsic value, and we tend to see this in reserves. Conservation is usually where we get into the thick of things, because you are taking into consideration other uses for natural resources. Again, these two are ski resort in Chile, and the photo on the right is from Holland, showing the ways that we use natural resources without necessarily harming that ecosystem, but utilizing it for recreation and other purposes, and building towns around rivers, for instance. I'm not going to read this entire definition from the EPA for environmental justice, but the point of having this slide is to show you that it is a complex concept, and agency language in the US can't be directly translated to Armenia or to many other places because it's based on what you tend to hear, the race, color, national origin, or income. Of course, the income does translate over, but we want to look at environmental justice in a more specific way. So there are four real types of environmental justice when we're looking at any given issue. Those are distributive, procedural, corrective, and social. And distributive environmental justice basically looks at protection and elimination of environmental risks for all. So instead of having a disproportionate amount of negative impacts on one part of society based on income, perhaps, as we know, Armenia is mostly Armenian, 99% of the world is. So we're looking mostly at income and socioeconomic indicators. You know, we don't want a disproportionate amount of negative impacts on one part of society versus another. And likewise, if there are benefits, payment for environmental services, or other types of benefits that can be arranged, you want that to be equitably distributed as well. Procedural environmental justice is where we get into public input and public access to information. So we see that in the Orkus Convention, we see that in our environmental impact laws, both in the US and in Armenia. This is about having the right to treatment as an equal, having equal concern and respect in political decisions, and most importantly, fairness in the decision-making process. So it really is talking about having, you know, an inclusive process, even if the outcome isn't what everyone wanted, the process is what is really being focused on under the rubric of procedural environmental justice. And some of the questions that we should be asking ourselves as we talk about Tevut and some of the other topics that will come up, because this really applies across the board, did the affected community agree in advance to the decision-making process of any of these mining projects, any other exploitative projects? Is there equality among the parties, including the affected community, in access to legal and technical resources? Almost never is this the case. And that's why it's so important to empower people, especially in rural areas, where these people simply just don't have this type of resource. They don't know what to ask, and they're given the information pretty much at, you know, the mercy of the company doing the project. And the indicators to look at for this would be sufficient notice of public hearings. So for instance, when we talk about Tehu, the first environmental impact assessment did have two public hearings. That included two public hearings. That's something they can take off on the markers, but was there sufficient notice? Was there enough access? Was the location convenient? These are things we really need to look at to see if it's a really transparent process. Inclusion in agency meetings. And the last one, the accessibility of important documents. I can tell you right now, we're trying to get the second environmental impact assessment, and we can't get it. So there was a second one, which I'll talk about in a moment. And so I can tell you, this is not being followed. Okay, corrective environmental justice. Seeks to impose accountability. It's more about remediation, reparations, damages, a lot of tort claims, obviously. We have some issues in the US with Superfund cases where there are toxic sites and residents have not been relocated. They are forced to live through the cleanup. So, and other times they are relocated. Cases throughout Latin America, you have pesticide manufacturers being pursued for poisoning some of the workers in Latin America. Those haven't been so successful, but we have had one precedent, actually just recently in February, where Chevron the court came back with an $18.2 billion verdict against Chevron for polluting parts of the rainforest in Ecuador, and not just polluting the rainforest, but affecting the people who live there. And that was a very long and drawn out case. It's actually a very interesting case. I could give a talk just on that. But it is an important precedent because it sets the stage for what multinationals need to start considering when they're operating in these countries without much enforcement of their own laws. And social environmental justice is something that really does overlap into some of the other issues that will be discussed today. And that is looking at the perspective of the people who are affected by these projects. So, you know, if you're a villager in northern Armenia, so that's my example, you know, you're going to see hazardous waste or you're going to see toxic tailings as equally important as the fact that you don't have a job and you can't feed your family. And these are things that we have to take into consideration. And we are taking them into consideration. And a more urban example, which was just recently mentioned, was Mashtots Park. So we do have a lack of green spaces in Yerevan. This is an issue, and it certainly, you know, goes back to having areas for recreation and being able to utilize the green spaces in Yerevan, but it's also a rule of law issue, and it's a social justice issue, because it was done illegally, and that's really what the activists were fighting. So I just want to, switching over to the Armenian context, I want to say that, you know, as many things, because Armenia is such an ancient place, you know, this is nothing new for Armenia. But looking at back about the last century or so, there was a lot of industrialization that went on in the Soviet times. There was a lot of draining of wetlands, for instance, and farms were put in their place. People were relocated for political reasons near the border with Turkey. You know, they put up factories, gave them jobs, but they had to truck water up to them, so water was never established underground. And now those factories are defunct, and we still have to truck water up to them, and they're very, very impoverished now. So, you know, looking at that trajectory, during the glasnost period, or strike period, actually environmental issues were paramount in bringing people together in the national movements. So Armenians have cared about their environment for a long time and how environment impacts them. Since it was mentioned in the opening remarks, I'll just kind of skip through this, but, you know, during the energy crisis, the green spaces were removed. That there were many, actually, in Yerevan before the war. And all the trees were cut, and, you know, the wooden plats off the park benches were taken for burning just to survive. So that's understandable. What has happened since then is less understandable. We also have other issues that, you know, I wish we could address all of them, but we don't have the time. So, you know, we have a nuclear energy power plant that is far past due for being shut down. You know, it's been voted the second most dangerous in the European community. And also, we're not following the procedure in place for disposal of nuclear waste. So these are major issues. And actually, my organization works on waste management as a project focus. So, you know, industrial, medical, municipal waste, these are all things that are impacting public health and killing off wildlife, you name it. And only the most basic water treatment in the urban areas. In the rural areas, no water treatment at all. So you can imagine this having a cumulative effect on public health. Deforestation is a huge issue. Most of you have probably heard about it. You know, there's been a very fast paced level of deforestation for many years now. This is actually from the Armenian Tree Project. This mapping was commissioned a few years ago, but if you take a look, you can see somewhat recent level of forest coverage. And in about 20 years or so, that's what will be left at the current rate. So if you look forward another 30, 40, 50 years, you can imagine we're not going to have much left. And that's really what brings us to Tehud. Tehud is a small forested area in the north of the country. If you can see it, I don't know, this little red dot at the top here, that's the area we're talking about. And it is one of Armenia's last old-growth virgin forests. Now, why is that important? That means that it's so old, the ecosystem is so established, that if you were to cut it down, and even if you were to replant, you will not get the same quality. Saplings and new growth is simply not going to be able to sustain the same level of biodiversity. It's not going to be able to sustain the same level of purity in the soil or in the water. So you're losing something even if you try to replant. This particular forest hosts over 300 species of birds, animals, and plants. And over 30 of them are listed as endangered. So the process, going back to the process of how this was done, over 200,000 hectares of land of this forest was leased to the Armenian Copper Program, which is VALIX, so you may know it as VALIX, for 25 years. That same company was granted rights for construction of ore processing, an ore processing plant and supportive structures and a bit more, a bigger area, for 50 years. It's also important to note that about 350 hectares, the number actually varies a little bit, but it's around 350 hectares will be clear cut for this project. Clear cutting means just wiping it out, taking out the trees, there'll be nothing left. they're saying they'll replant in that area, but even the areas surrounding that will still be impacted. You have secondary effects. You have water, you know, you're going to muddy the waters. There's tailings that are going to go in the waters. You're destroying that ecosystem. So it's important to note that, especially if they're looking at 50 years for supportive structures, the ongoing, you know, it's not even going to be left alone until at least 50 years out. So that's something to think about in terms of cumulative effect. The project so far, $280 million have been invested. $30 million have come from BALIX, or the Armenian Copper Project, or program. And $245 million have come from VTB. It's a bank in Russia. And that was actually held up for a few years for economic reasons. So you may have heard of Tufenkian a few years ago, maybe. It was becoming a big issue in 2007, 2008. Well, it was the reason that it was put on hold, and no one really knew why at the time, it was because the loan was held up for economic reasons. Now it's back, and we're dealing with the same issue again. Just to give you a little backdrop, 81% of ACP shares belong to Valix, which was the parent company originally, and it is registered in Liechtenstein, which I'll get to in a minute. 19% is owned by Valery Mezhlumian, and some of you may know him. He's a diasporan from Russia. The impacts, the projected impacts of this project, 60,000 tons of molybdenum will be projected to be dumped into the Debit River. This is a picture from Jeff Masargin of the Armenian Tree Project, who's very kind in sharing many of his photos with me, dumped into the Akhtala River, which eventually does feed into Debit River as well. You can see the impact. I don't even mean to tell you how much damage is being done to this ecosystem. Again, if you can see the colors here, that is not really water anymore. Again, just to look at the company, it is privately held, it's registered in Liechtenstein. It has a history of not acting properly in terms of public input. So again, the environmental impact assessment that was done, the original one, you know, they say they did two public hearings. Well, that's great, but how was it done? And was it really done in a transparent way? Just to give you an idea of where this is all going, 2007 reports show that the copper, 90% of the copper went to Germany and the rest to other European countries. I will say this, Valix is the only mining company functioning in Armenia which has even tried to do an environmental impact assessment, in just to say that. However, they need to do it correctly. If they're going to say it, they can't greenwash it. They have to do it properly, and we need to hold the other companies accountable as well. Again, just to go back over a little bit about the environmental impact assessment, which is in place to bring into account all of those things we talked about, the economic, social, and environmental aspects of each project that is that may have an impact on the environment. It was carried out by Valix, but it was also funded by Valix. It was funded and also conducted by one of its own companies. So you can see the clear conflict of interest here. We've recently, we have an operations office in Yerevan. And recently, our programs director spoke with a representative of Valix who told us that a second EIA, environmental impact assessment, has been done. And they can show it to us. And they did actually show them some sort of document, which was in English, but was very, very thick. And they just let the programs director of my organization, as well as a few other activists, were able to look through it very quickly, about 10 minutes. Didn't really get the full gist of what was going on, obviously. So we asked, can you please release this document so we can review it? And to this date, they say, okay, well, our lawyers are saying that we can't. The company's saying that we can't. So that's wonderful that you did the second EIA premised on an improperly done first EIA, but no public hearings were held for the second one. We didn't even know about it till about a month ago, and we still can't get a hold of it. So we're basically acting as if it's not there because we don't have it to work. As far as how locals in Armenia are viewing this problem, this is often the case throughout the world, different development projects. Urban areas, you know, you have a population that's able to look at the situation and see the long-term costs. So you do have, as you can see, some activists coming out, and they're more or less the same group of people who are, you know, acting on other issues like Mashtots Park, and recently Turchkov as well. Which was a waterfall, and it was going to be subject to a hydroelectric dam, a hydroelectric project, and it was overturned pretty quickly, actually, very, very quickly, after some protests by these activists. So you know, you can see that there's some people who are up in arms about it, but we also have to think of the villagers. Most of the villagers are pro-mining, and not because they want environmental degradation, not because they want to poison their own waters, but as we've talked about the other issues that are equally important to them, we have to think, okay, well, what else can they do? They're being given, you know, incomplete information. They don't know what to ask. They certainly don't have the legal or technical resources to be on fair footing with a company that has the resources that we just discussed. And, you know, what can they do? What more can they say? Oh, you want to give me money right now and I can feed my family? There have been recent allegations of this mining company, some of its representatives beating some of the villagers. So now it is becoming controversial, and the villagers are trying to look at the situation and see what can be done. But from this point forward, we need cross-communication between people with resources, and that includes us in the diaspora, as well as the activists in Yerevan. We need to become one with the people who are actually being directly impacted by this project and other projects. This is not the only one. So it is a small but strong opposition group, which I will let the other speakers get to. I know that they'll be discussing it as well. It is mostly youth, but that is not, you know, that it's growing, and it's not only youth, and that is comforting to know. And it really shouldn't be, because it's affecting all of us. It's affecting all of our families and all of our friends. So what can you do today? I want to leave on sort of an upbeat note. I feel like I've probably depressed a lot of people. So, you know, you can get involved. I know my organization, we need all the help we can get, and we're actually going to be listing at least 10 positions that we need filled, including working on this campaign for Tehud. So if you are interested, please either contact me, you can come and talk to me. We also have some flyers out on the table with our contact information. We'd be happy to have you. But aside from that, you can also write to the Armenian Embassy here, the US Embassy there. You can join campaigns, and we are working on some campaigns. And think of ways you can donate your own time and expertise. You know, people often ask for donations of money. We can use that, of course, but your time and expertise are just as necessary, if not more so. The best thing you can do is really to go. If you're just going for 2 weeks, you can't get away for longer than that, make it a working vacation. Meet with some of these activists. Meet with the organizations that are really making a difference. And ask them, how can I help you once I go home? How can I be of service? Obviously, if you have time and you can go for longer, there are organizations that can help you with that. I believe the minimum is usually 2 months with Birthright ABC, but they'll take people up to a year. And we also have a couple of volunteers who are doing student exchange programs who happen to be in Armenia. They're from the US, and other individual organizations do it too. So do a bit of research. If you're going, why not make it a working vacation and really leave with something, you know, and say you did something while you were there. And we will be posting more about Tehud and other projects as well. We are a network, and we have a lot of partners who are doing great work who don't post to their own websites. I think they're just really, really busy. So we have a lot of information that will be going up on our website, so please visit, and if you have any questions, feel free to contact us. I do want to give credit to the photos that I didn't say were mine or address. Those other photos of Tehud were all from this Facebook page, which you can easily join and stay abreast of the situation. You can get daily updates. They're constantly updating that with news in Armenian and English. So you can just look up Save Tehud Forest, and it will come right up. And they're great people. And that is it. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Ursula. Okay, moving on, our next speaker is known to most of you, investigative journalist Edik Baghdasaryan from Yerevan. Edik's career is characterized by a singular goal of defending freedom of speech, demanding transparency and accountability. He's editor-in-chief of Hetq online daily newspaper and founder of the investigative journalists NGO in Armenia. In addition to his work in Hetq, Mr. Baghdasaryan has produced over 50 documentaries and investigative films that have garnered awards and accolades internationally. Among his successful and notable projects include the following: a series on Armenia's homeless, which resulted in the establishment of a winter shelter by the Armenian government, series on abuse of children at an Armenian seminary in Calcutta, India, which resulted in immediate action by Echmiadze, and a series on trafficking of Armenian women in the United Arab Emirates, which resulted in a dozen criminal cases against officials, pimps, and others engaged in human trafficking and enslavement of women. Truly a remarkable figure, truly one worth listening to and adhering to. I introduce Edik Baghdasaryan. I'm sorry, Edik will speak in Armenian and his translation will be provided by Kasbarian.
Հնարավորության համար որպես քաշուկեմ ձեր հետ եւ ինչ որ մտքեր քիսեմ Հայաստանի իրավիճակի լրագրողական համայնքի եւ խնդիրների մասին.
Thanks for the opportunity to be here and present the situation of the media and the community of people who man the media, staff the media.
Այս ամբիոնները չեմ սիրում.
I don't like these podiums.
Համալսարանում 10 եմ տալիս մի անգամ եկանեն ասեցի որ մենք լսարանի ցամբիոնը անենք որը միշտ ուսանողները քալել ասես չի լինի այնպես ոչ
I teach at the university and I asked the coordinator there to remove the podium and he said, because I'd like to be among the students and he said how's that possible
մի քիչ դժվար է իրավաբանների հետ խոսել որտեղ իրավաբանները մի քիչ տարբերվում են
It's a little tough to speak to lawyers because they're a little bit different. I have some material prepared that I'd like to present, but you always have to prepare according to your audience so that you can actually wake people up, get through. And especially since you're in the midst of elections here, we just got done with Armenia, and now you're stuck with them. And I hope there isn't the kind of funny business here that there was there. A few words about Hetq. I used to be a TV journalist in Armenia, but it was cyclical. I'd get a few programs on the air, and then they'd throw me off. We decided in 2000 to create an investigative journalists organization. And in 2001, we went online with Hetq. And that's despite the fact that at the time there wasn't much internet access in Armenia, but we saw that what voted for the future and want to go that route. And I think that was the right way to go. We've been able to keep up with the times. It was really tough in the early days because Armenia had carried on all the ills of the Soviet Union and we had to work in that environment. There was no tradition in the country of anything except grabbing what you could and fraud and these kinds of things. Anything we did, we had to start from scratch. And that was the fundamental problem in Armenia. We didn't have a generation of people who hadn't been tainted by the corruption, by the selling of votes and so forth, that just didn't exist. And it was very dangerous to function as a reporter in that kind of environment. We gained people's confidence over the years. And the important thing is that that confidence isn't just among our readers, but even among government officials. We're different from most other media in Armenia in that we're not connected to any of the partisan media. We're not connected to any of the political factions. We're not connected to anyone. And people have come to know and recognize this. That there aren't any officials from the Republic of Armenia here, right? It's a little tougher to speak about people when they're not present. It's strange. You'd think that to resolve any issue, you need to interact, you need to discuss issues, and yet bureaucrats tend to fear that interaction in Armenia and here, but we have to oblige them to do it. But we've made some real progress, because we're at a point now where even government ministers will contact us to get our input, to get our opinions about any issues, about the military, about corruption, whatever it might be, so that that level of interaction and comfort now exists. One example is the recent spate of killings in the army. I have to note that the army is one of our most stable institutions. The army and the media are probably the most stable institutions in Armenia, and especially the army is a matter of real pride for us. I met with the defense ministers of Armenia and Qarabağ. And they agreed that they allow access to the military by the media. And we've been able to organize two field trips already to the front lines, and the rules are the reporters have full access. They can ask whoever, whatever they want. And the ability to examine the unfortunate events that I mentioned earlier. And the proof's in the pudding. They don't like us, but they do recognize us, they do sit down with us, and that is a good place to be. We have a lot of scandals. It's on an almost weekly basis, we're reporting on something that had a lot of repercussions. We didn't see, years ago, we'd never see results of these investigations. But now it's at the point where after almost every one of our articles, our investigations, we're able to make some changes. But there's a number of instances now where, as a consequence of our investigations, various employees, bureaucrats, have been taken to court and penalized. We're now, one of our flaws perhaps is that we take a long time on all our investigations. We feel compelled to gather all the information we possibly can before we go forward with it, because otherwise we'd be very susceptible to lawsuits. As it is, we're involved in three of them right now. And things have improved, as I suspected they might early on when we started this whole process. I looked to the U.S. and said that, you know, everybody's gone through this, and indeed, my guess was right, it has improved as far as how we're being perceived or how susceptible we are to those types of attacks. And we also face another unfortunate reality in that many people see that their last court, their last opportunity really is the media and not the courts, because we don't have a functioning judicial system, a properly functioning judicial system in Armenia. I was listening to some of the conversations that you as attorneys were having, and it occurs to me that perhaps you could have some input in improving the situation that I just described.
Edik, Kalakapitaranits, Najarian, Hadetichem Skalum, and Sabakutan Basumer, Glendale, Chikdemek, and Galatun, Banakhisin, Alvela, and my yester roommate, Anjargolian.
Yesterday I was talking to Aram Najarian, city council member in Glendale, and he was describing how we're building the city up and with great pride that the Armenian communities contribute so much. Well, I was actually saddened by that.
Ես ուզենայի ասենք, որ դիսի բան խոսքեր ասել, չգիտեմ, Շուշիի քաղաքապետը, Ստեփանակերտի քաղաքապետը, մեր գյուղերի գովապետները, որ մենք զարգանում ենք. Ես տխրում եմ, որտեղ ասում են հայերի թիվը ավելանում են, բայց ես դրանից հետ չլավ չեմ զգում, որտեղ այդ հայերը Հայաստանից են գալիս այստեղ.
I'm saddened by that because I'd like to see our mayors in Shushi and Stepanakert in our small villages saying the very same things, and that building up that's happening here is happening at the expense of people leaving Armenia, and that's not what I want to see. We need to build up our institutions there.
Thank you.
I appeal to you to put your expertise to use in Armenia, whether it be improving the laws or the judicial system. I'm not talking about financial inputs, but rather your know-how and your ability to contribute to the types of improvements that we need in the country. It really is tough in Armenia. We don't have the experts, the specialists. I was talking to Garo the other day about how all humans have good and bad aspects to them. Unfortunately, in Armenia, it seems like everything's being done to allow the bad side to grow. I have a number of students, obviously, in my journalism classes that I can't hire. I do have some of them, and others are now represented in all the other media and in government institutions. Those students know that they're not supposed to be lying or presenting false fronts to the people. They know what they're supposed to do, but within a month of working in that environment, they're completely different people. That negative, oppressive environment in Armenia is very powerful, and that's why we can't make progress. And any youth that enter into government service are quickly sucked into that. It's really impossible to compare, to explain just how much things have improved for the media. The advent of social media has been a real blessing in that it's taken a lot of the pressure off of us. Previously, we'd have footage that no TV station would air, and we've had great difficulty loading it onto the web, but now with Facebook and others, anybody can shoot anything and it's up there, and it's really helped our work. Even though Facebook is also a major source of disinformation as well. As a rule, some 80% of what's on Facebook is not correct. And then they have retractions or rebuttals published. Are you bored or shall I go on? Would you like me to speak on some other topic? Let me speak about civil society a little bit. Ursula spoke to that a little bit.
Yes.
6 months ago I was saying that the elections we just had are going to be more of the same as what we've had in previous rounds of elections. Because neither the people nor the bureaucracy was ready for anything else. I had a crazy idea about 2 years ago, and I said, we've got to do this. We weren't able to do it fully, but there are some hopeful signs that we did have some success with it. Mariam Sukhudyan and I together, you probably heard of her, right, the activist? We'd go to small towns and villages and meet with the youth of those habitations. And we spoke about everything. Environment, education, marriage. How am I going to translate that? White trash. And we're trying to energize them and activate them by conveying to them that they were the future of Armenia. I don't know how closely you follow developments in Armenia, but there were a couple of big demonstrations, environmentally themed demonstrations in Hrastan. We didn't advertise this or broadcast this very loudly, but some people knew that we were meeting with the kids, and the idea was that our people, our civil society has to come take ownership of what's going on in the country. Unfortunately, there's such an outflow of people from Armenia, immigration is so strong that we can't get the pot to boil. As soon as some young person gets a little bit activated, energized, involved, the next thing they're thinking about is how to leave the country. And just these last few days, walking the streets here, I saw some of my friends. And I wasn't gladdened by this, by meeting my friends, because I'd say to them, you've left us alone. And all I could think about was how in my phone list I'd be removing people's names as they left the country. And that's really profoundly impactful because you just don't know who to turn to cooperate with, to wage these battles that we've got going, that we must continue. I don't know just how aware you are that the situation in Armenia is really not good. When you travel to the border villages and all you see are grandmas and grandpas, you can't help but think that this is how you lose a country, a state.
Martin
And this is one of those imperceptible processes. People don't see it, people don't feel it, as it happens ever so slowly, and then all of a sudden you see that there's all 10 people left in some village.
Ես գիտեմ, որ Հայաստանում վատ է, ես գիտեմ, որ կոռուպցիա կա, ես գիտեմ, որ մեր պաշտոնյաները կաշառակեր են, որ նրանք մտածում են միայն փող աշխատելու մասին.
I know things are bad in Armenia. I know there's corruption. I know that our bureaucrats think about nothing except how to make a few more pennies.
Չի գիտեմ, հայերը մի հիվանդությունն են, ուզում են երկրորդ օրը հարուստ լինեն. Աշխատանքի գնան եւ հաջորդ օրը մեծ փող ունեն.
There seems to be this Armenian disease, you know, we want to start working on something and the next day we want to be filthy rich. And it's not possible to do that in Armenia, so you got to steal. You've got people leaving the country, coming here and engaging in credit card fraud or something like that, and it's just absurd. It's unimaginable. How can somebody even sit down and conceive of such a gimmick, such a racket? And that's a completely different topic, but that's got to be written up and exposed also so that Armenians in Armenia realize that it's not all wonderful here either, so that they know about the difficulties here, they know what the reality here is of life. They must understand that the American dream is not the Armenian dream. We have to have our dream in our country. Antranig says I'm talking too much, but I'll be happy to answer questions later.
Thank you very much, Edik. Yes, we will continue with Edik and the others during the Q&A. Okay, our third and final speaker is Sara Anjargolian, known to many of you as well. She's a documentarian and an attorney focused on visual storytelling projects that seek to inspire social change. She's a recipient of a Fulbright scholarship and a United Nations award for her work, and she has partnered with numerous nonprofit organizations to raise awareness of humanitarian causes around the world. Her body of work has been exhibited widely and most recently includes Story of AIDS and Drug-Resistant Tuberculosis Among the Zulu People of South Africa, How We Live, a photography installation within film documenting poverty in Armenia, Not Here, a project focusing on labor migration from Armenia to Los Angeles, and Zen a Dancer, feature film in Turkey about the honor killing of a gay man by his father. Okay. Her presentation is entitled This Country Belongs to Us, Reclaiming the Republic. Sara?
Thanks so much for the Armenian Bar Association for organizing this conference, and specifically for making Armenia and social justice issues in Armenia a focus. I'm going to end this panel, hopefully, on a high, positive note. My sole goal for the next 20 minutes is to introduce you to the activists who are doing really awesome work in Armenia. And I'm going to do that visually, through video and through photos. The first part of my presentation is going to feature a 5-minute short film that was actually created by our friend Robert Davidian, who's sitting here in the front row. I'm going to start with that video, then go through some case studies, again visually through photographs, about the various social movements in Armenia, and then end again with a 3-minute video. So the first video is 5 minutes, and here it goes.
Unfortunately, in Armenia, we do not experience free and fair elections.
People lie, people cheat, it's part of the Soviet psychology. boys, young boys of 18, 20 dying in the army, being killed, and the ones who killed them never being prosecuted and put in jail.
Violence against women is an issue in Armenia, and we need to talk about it.
If you are not majority, if you are not one of them, you suffer.
If this process will go to the active stage, we will have a water polluted by heavy and toxic metals. It will be a catastrophe.
Whenever people do not see that they are citizens, that they have a respect, that their vote has a respect, they just want to escape this country.
I wonder if anyone thinks that he or she is going to avoid this kind of injustices. It can happen to all of us. And unless we are together and we organize to fight things, it's gonna happen again and again.
There's a good group of active citizens, young people, older people who are really coming together to address these issues.
Today we see that when we are doing protests, even with 20 people, the government and the ministries, they are sending a lot of police because they are scared of even a few dedicated activists.
Visiting to ordinary people houses and asking them and pushing them to not participate. It is illegal to do that, no?
Of course. Անշամակակը այնպես է կողմնոցված պետական ապարատը.
The whole system is such a corruption.
Բնականաբար տեղ չի ունենում մարդու իրավունքների մտածողության.
There is no place for human rights thinking.
When you see that somehow the law does not work in your country, when you see that there are laws that are only on the paper and that are not being implemented, you already lose your trust.
There's also a lot of fear towards addressing things that is related directly or indirectly to government. Also, there are a lot of dangers.
They
are here to fight for their freedom because they want to fight for the future of their children and they want to live in rural
act persistently and intensely.
You can make a difference.
Of course we will succeed.
I'm Sona Ayvazyan, Transparency International Anti-Corruption Center.
Georg Tergabrian and I'm the country director of Eurasia Partnership Foundation.
My name is Artinek Alfayan. I work for the Institute for Democracy and Human Rights.
Artur Sokins, one of the office of Helsinki Citizens Estonia.
I'm Lara. And I work at the Women's Resource Center in Armenia.
I'm Armenian Bar Association. I work in this organization. The full name is Public Information and of Knowledge. We call it just PINK.
Shushan Doydoyan, head of the Freedom of Information Center.
I'm Tigran Chorokyan, Freedom of Initiative in Non-Smoking Campaign in Yerevan.
Sathya Kitafyan, Temporary Disability Analysis.
Bora Sogomonyan, this city belongs to us.
I'm Olya Azadyan. I'm involved in a lot of activities that is connected with the activism in Armenia.
Tanis Arksyan, PR responsible of Women's Rights Center Armenia.
I am Nobodan.
Hello, I'm Artur, I'm a blogger.
My name is Carla Garapetyan.
Salahat Petrosyan.
Nale Araman.
Arman Garibyan.
Danish Patelyan.
My name is Amasya.
People power.
So in the next 10-15 minutes, I'm going to do several case studies in terms of the various social movements that the people you saw in this video have undertaken and are pushing forward in Armenia. The first one is the Mashtos Park social movement that just recently concluded. And I'd like to show you through imagery what these did at Mashtos Park. Basically, Mashtos Park was a space in central Yerevan. You can see it right there on the map. And it was a relatively green space. I mean, there was some debate about whether or not it was very well taken care of, but it was still an open space. And what happened was that the municipality announced that it was going to take this space and build boutiques, rather move boutiques. So there was these boutiques on Abovian Street, and the municipality decided that they were going to move those boutiques because they were an eyesore on Abovian and just move them directly into this park. And so here are the boutiques. And they started to build them, and the these activists who got together, many of them, by the way, are also very involved with Tevut and environmental activism in Armenia, stood up and said, you know, there has been absolutely no rule of law, no process, no notice in terms of moving these boutiques and taking over our public space, and we won't stand for it. You can see some photographs here. I don't know if you could, maybe the lights should have stayed down, I'm not sure. This is kind of a more of a visual presentation. You don't really need to see me. and you know, these boutiques were built in all kinds of different ways, obviously damaging these trees, as you can see. And there's all types of urban planning laws on the books in Armenia in terms of what you need to do if you're going to be taking over a public space. And none, if not very few, of those laws were actually respected in this. So a group of people, first small and then increasingly larger, stood up and began to organize an Occupy-style movement. And in some sense, they called it Occupy Mashtos Park. And they began to sleep there. Here's a couple pictures of the activists actually sleeping there. It became a place for people to interact, play music, arts and culture were brought to Mashtos Park, evening concerts to entertain the people who were going to spend the night there. And of course, the municipality was sent out and kept 24-hour watch at Mashtos Park by the police. So basically, it was this space where the police were occupying it and the activists were occupying it. And there would be these very lively debates between the activists and the police, and basically that's what it was in the beginning. And there was a lot of usage of nonviolent resistance type activities. Several activists actually stopped the cement trucks from coming into that space. There was very creative messaging that you saw out of Mashtos Park, including signs and symbols of unity. They had some fun with the oligarchs there. And once the snow melted, they actually decided to stage a funeral of the oligarch. And so here's the oligarch's funeral. They were very, very sophisticated about it, actually. Paraded the oligarch through Republic Square, had a proper funeral for him. And one of the activists, well, I really like this quote, I thought I'd share it with you, said that the procession was symbolic not only in terms of burying the oligarch of Armenia, but in terms of burying the mentality of greed and injustice that they spawned. The activists believe that the high-rise buildings that you see along Northern Avenue, the cafes that encircle the opera, the commercial kiosks that were illegally being built everywhere were symbols of the dominance of the oligarchs in Armenian society. I love this picture because he's really taking it very seriously. He wore black, he has a white carnation. This is one of the mourners who came out to bury the oligarch. Halfway through the movement, there was a very interesting twist. Some of the older generation of intellectuals, political scientists, artists joined the younger activists. They, which showed up in this construction garb, and the idea was they were the deconstruction brigade, and that they would come and, again, using nonviolent resistance, would move in and would deconstruct these kiosks, which they felt were built illegally. There was lots of tug of wars between the deconstruction brigade and the police. Lots of different scuffles, no major, I wouldn't say anybody got hurt, but there were certainly scuffles between the activists and the deconstruction brigade and the police as they would try to jump the barriers and to deconstruct these kiosks. And the more people showed up, the more police showed up. The big sticking point was this tent. The activists kept on insisting that it was their right to sleep in this park and to be able to put up a tent and actually occupy it in this tent. The tent ended up becoming a real point of contention, I guess, with the police, where they believed that no tents would be allowed in this park. And this tent actually ended up leading to the main instances of violence from the police towards the activists. So 7 activists were actually arrested at Mashko's Park. This picture made the rounds on Facebook. But they were released the next day. And here's one of the activists, Bahram Solomonia, who you just saw, and with this city belongs to us social movement. And minutes before he was released, they went right back to Mashto's Park, and he said, "I want to stay and live in this country. I don't want to leave this country, and no one can push us out." So it's the same idea that you heard Edik talk about. These ideas are very embedded in these social movements. The interesting twist that happened at Mashto's Park a few days after the activists were arrested and released and a few days before the election was that they had a very unexpected visitor. The president shows up and in just a few minutes walks around Mashto's Park with the mayor and tells the mayor that he did everything right, that everything was correct. Even he complimented the police in their... in terms of how they held themselves. But then he kind of made this quiet and flippant remark saying, you know, it's just not very beautiful. They're not very nice, these kiosks. Let's remove them. And so in that instance, the 90 days at Mashto's Park basically went from activists yelling and screaming for rule of law to, presidential fiat in a way. And of course, the activists didn't take that. I mean, they quickly took that statement, "Gerecikçe apa montajek," it's not pretty, get rid of it, and they plastered that all over the city. And of course, Edik also took his shots at it, circumventing the law for a presidential photo op. But the bottom line with Mashto's Park that I believe is very important is that although the activists were very celebratory, they were super excited that the kiosks were going to be deconstructed, and it was that in a sense they won, right? They got what they wanted. So there was certainly a lot of celebration, but the message that ultimately came out from the activists was, and they have it, this is in Armenian and that's the English translation, is that it wasn't about the kiosks per se, but it's that the rule of law needed to be followed, and it's not the president's aesthetic whims that are important. And that acts contrary to the rule of law should be punished, not praised. And they keep pushing this idea that they are self-determined citizens. And so although they considered the outcome great, they really did try to distinguish between outcome and the process by which it got there. That's Mashto's Park. I'm going to move along to a couple of precursors to Mashto's Park. I believe that the activists we saw in these images really got a lot of confidence in 2 or 3 other victories that came before Mashto's Park. One was the Tushkan waterfall, which is in northern Armenia, Lori, which Ursula touched upon. This was a waterfall that's probably one of the biggest and most beautiful waterfalls in Armenia that was going to be, a hydroelectric plant was going to be building on it and therefore drying it up. There would no longer be a waterfall. The activists camped out at Tushkan and after several days of basically occupying that area and many different things that happened, meetings and protests, etc., attacking the Prime Minister's Facebook page, they reversed that decision, and Tushkan is, for the time being, not going to have a hydroelectric plant dry it up. Same with Dragon Park in Yerevan. This is a park where there are 3,000-year-old dragon stones. And the city of Yerevan handed this park over to an individual who was going to build a 10-story building. And besides destroying the green space and ruining the park aesthetically, the larger issue was that it was illegal because the dragon sculptures were found on the Armenian monument and preservation list, and according to the law, they can't be disturbed. So within a few months, the activists actually did win the right to preserve this park. On the topic of preservation of historical monuments and building buildings and public spaces, there's a very strong movement to try to preserve the buildings, the old city of Yerevan, from further deconstruction. One of the positive outcomes is that the open air theater of the Moscow Cinema's open air theater, which is an important example of late 1960s modern architecture and was on the list of historical and cultural monuments, was taken off the list by the government, and a demolition was announced in order to make room to build a church. The activists, within just a few days, hit the streets. They collected 26,000 signatures to save this theater, and the demolition was stopped. Although the theater was not returned to the list of historical and cultural monuments. So they're keeping an eye to see what the next step is going to be. It's been positive and negative. There's been some instances in which the activists have been able to save or make a dent in terms of preserving historical buildings around Yerevan, and in some other cases they have been unable to. These are just some of the buildings that are at issue. Moving along to the issues related to the military, there's a movement called the Army in Reality Movement, and basically they are a group of activists as well as the mothers of soldiers who have died in non-combat deaths. Last year there were 17, and this year so far there's been 13 non-combat deaths, and mostly it seems to be some sort of hazing or disciplinary actions that are leading to the deaths of these young men. Edik could probably speak more to that as he has, you know, he has more of an inside scoop on the military. But there's a very strong and active group of people that shows up every Thursday in front of the government buildings, mostly the mothers of these young men, and they are pushing to have a transparent approach and further information about how it is that their sons died, because they contend that although some say there was suicides and this and that, that truly the information exchange in terms of the military to the mothers and the families of these young men has not been transparent. And they have posters, whose child is next, and this type of messaging. I want to take a minute to note that this organization, the Armenian Bar Association, was one of the few diaspora organizations that wrote a letter to the president expressing our concern for the non-combat deaths and suggesting perhaps that anti-hazing policy or some other type of policy could help in this matter. There is really a huge sensitivity to discussions as it relates to the military. This young man wrote a book, a fiction book, I might add, about his experience. Well, he says it's not about his experience, but he had just come out of the military, and he wrote a book of short stories that was fiction about the experience a young man has in the military, and he was called for questioning, and there was some talk about ultimately prosecuting him. That case seems to have been dropped at this point, and there were many of us here who wrote and who made a big stink about that. Moving on to LGBT rights, the organization Pink and many of its supporters and activists are trying to establish LGBT rights in Armenia and to educate educate the public on LGBT issues. They're very sophisticated in their messaging and in the activities that they propose in Yerevan. And more than LGBT issues, they really do try to open minds as it relates to people who live differently or people who maybe not, you know, the same as you are. And they are very strong in terms of trying to deal with prejudice and discrimination. They organize conferences. For example, this one is about masculinity, breaking the stereotypes, imagine that happening in Armenia, as well as information about HIV AIDS and other issues that would relate to LGBT rights. This movement had a big setback this week. We all know, I think most people in this audience know that there was a bombing. Two young men threw Molotov cocktails into a bar called DIY in Yerevan. And you can see the before and after pictures here. It's a bar where a lot of progressive people hang out, artists, I've been there myself, and these two young men were angry because the owner of the bar went to Turkey to march in the gay pride parade. And they also believe that this place is sort of a den of perversion, where all kinds of people, unsavory people, specifically as it relates to the gay community, hang out. Swastikas were painted on the outside of this bar. In an interesting turn of events, several parliament members, rather than speak out against the people who bombed this bar, actually came out with statements such, this is the vice president of the National Assembly, he came out and said, to all of those trying to protect those homosexuals who are perverting our society and defaming the Armenian national identity, first and foremost, I encourage the protection of universal and national values, basically referring to the two men who bombed the bar. Another member of the National Assembly said that people like Tomak, who's the person who owns this bar, are ruining our society, and at the very least, all of us should keep our children and those around us away from her. This is really an issue of safety for our society. I wanted to share with you a note that I got. I'm in constant contact with many of the activists on these various social movements, and this is a note I got on Facebook, a private note I got on Facebook from one of the people involved in LGBT issues in Armenia, and she said, we really need your support. Open letters, personal contact, calls to the Armenian government are necessary now. Our lives are really in danger. We don't know what to expect tomorrow. Unfortunately, there's also some hate Facebook pages related to this issue, and we were successful in shutting it down by complaining to Facebook that this is a hate speech. However, unfortunately, it popped right up again. So this is the old one, this is the new one. If you see it, please click and report it as hate speech. Interestingly, what I found fascinating on these pages is that it's all about the Armenian family, and that in some way the recognition of LGBT rights is going to ruin the Armenian family, and anyone who sympathizes is also a threat to the nation. So this is the sort of general messaging that's coming out of these hate groups. And while we're on the topic of strong Armenian family, I thought it was apropos to discuss domestic violence in Armenia. Because on the one hand, we have these groups talking about the strong Armenian family needing to be protected, yet on the other hand, the same parliament members don't seem to want to talk about the fact that there's 30% domestic violence in Armenian families. There is a very well-organized and strong coalition dealing with domestic violence issues in Armenia. Including the Women's Resource Center, the Tufenkian Foundation, and several other NGOs. They hit the streets and they are trying to change the mentality and the words that are used as it relates to domestic violence, specifically that if you're a real man, you don't hit, and that the victim is never at fault. So these are things that, that the NGO community is trying to shift. Also, as it relates to women's liberation issues, for example, the same group, the same two NGOs, as well as several other NGOs, got together and they did a symbolic burying of the red apple. This is an old traditional Armenian, it's an Armenian tradition, I guess you can say, where a red apple is given from the to the bride's family if she turns out to be a virgin. So this is something that the women's organizations are pushing very strongly against, and they did this burying of the red apple. A couple of other social movements that deal with just regular livability, just day-to-day life issues. For example, the marshutkas in Armenia. Anybody who's been has seen these over-the-top, totally crowded marshutkas. Not only are there, you know, 20 people for 10 seats, but on top of it, the driver is smoking. So there's been a very strong and fairly successful movement to dignified and smoke-free transportation. People still sit on each other's laps, but at least nowadays, the drivers are not smoking as much. And obviously, there's other all kinds of other social movements. This could, you know, we could go on forever on this. There's animal protection issues as well. Just to conclude, a couple of thoughts that I had as it relates to these social movements. It's a small, but it's a growing mass of people who reject the domination of the oligarchs and are demanding accountability and rule of law in Armenia. Their notions are, the notion that seems to run through these social movements is that you can organize around an idea and not necessarily around a political candidate or a party. And in fact, these social movements are super adamant not to be affiliated with the political parties for fear of becoming pawns of the politicians. And most surprising to me was that they are trying as much as they can to refuse money from the more established grant-making organizations, again, because they don't want to be criticized as receiving money, quote-unquote, from the West in order to destabilize the country, which is one of the biggest criticisms that these activists receive. Obviously, Facebook has been huge in organizing these social movements. For example, the Tamil Facebook page has 6,355 members. On the one hand, you get excited when you see those numbers. On the other hand, in terms of who hits the streets, there are only maybe a few hundred, maybe even 100, maybe less, depending on the day. So there's, on the one hand, it's a powerful tool because, I mean, I've seen how fast some of these young people organize around issues just in terms of the information exchange. On the other hand, it does lend to a little bit of slacktivism, where people hang out at home and they click like and they make some really strong posts, but they actually never leave, you know, the comfort of their living room to hit the streets. So it's going to be very interesting to see how this changes or does not change. And also, I just want to note that clearly for me and for many others, Facebook and social media has been the best way that we've been able to become involved and informed about what's going on there and be able to reach out to the activists and lend them support. There's a small group of us here, very informal group of us, that get together and have Skype calls with Armenia, with these activists, and ask them what they need and ask them, you know, how it's going. And just the fact that you may post something on their page and they know it's coming from Los Angeles or Norway or wherever, it's a huge boost for them. They're super hungry for creative messaging, and they've reached out to myself as well as other people asking for new and different ways to organize and to get their message out. So they're super open to ideas and information exchange, as well as professionals going to Armenia and helping them organize. Before I show the last 3-minute clip I have, I just wanted to say a huge thanks to Robert, who's sitting here in the front row, because I'm going to show the end of his film. This film has not been released yet, and he's still working on it, but he allowed me to show it here, so I just wanted to say thank you, Robert, for that. And thank you to all the activists you worked with to put this film together. And of course, when you make one of these presentations, you pretty much grab everything off of Facebook. So as much as I could, I wanted to thank all these amazing photographers who share their work on Facebook every day in order to keep us involved in these various social movements. So I'm going to show you a 3-minute video, and then I think we all look forward to your questions.
This is the beginning of the process, and I don't know where it will lead to, but at least we have the idea of the place we want to live in, the idea of policies we want to create, and we have people who are volunteers who believe in what they are doing, and I think this is a big power, and this is able to change things.
Take the destiny of this country in your hands and become active citizen of this country.
Even in our country that is not so democratic and not so free, but if people really want to do some changes, they will reach it.
So they need to go to election, they need to vote, they need to understand that that's their very basic opportunity to make a difference, to vote.
When you see that each resident of the community is able to conceive that he is able to contribute to the solving of the problem, we can see the change of the person.
People should believe themselves that they can be the change agents.
We can do anything we want. All we need is just a little patience and a hard working.
We have new, well-educated, young people who don't want to be part of this corrupt system. They want to bring an alternative.
I believe if there is even 10 active people, 10 active young strong people, something is going to be changed.
Even one person, even one word can change Armenia, can change our mentality, can make it better.
Come and join us, because our struggle is your struggle, our victory is everyone's victory.
That's cool, like it makes you happy to be engaged in something.
Martin Luther King said injustice anywhere is a threat to justice everywhere. So be confident that we can change anything.
Of course we have hope, because it's very difficult to live without hope.
And I really do hope that one day we're going to live in a country at least with a low level of corruption, if not totally without it.
You can fight corruption. You are protected by the law. The law is on your side.
It will be hard just to struggle against them, but we are not going to just give up.
The diaspora is listening to you. Men and women are listening to you, young and old. We're now between the old Armenia and the new Armenia, and you are part of the new Armenia. Don't think that you aren't being heard. Make a difference in Armenia.
Every single person can make a difference. This idea is really very important, because if anybody stands and says that I can't do anything, I can't change anything, we really won't change anything.
The word impossible itself says that it is possible. I am possible.
Sara and colleagues, thank you very much. Okay, folks, the floor is yours. We'll take your questions seated here. So, who would like to get the ball rolling? Yes, sir.
We understand that the Armenian criminal code is changing such that the defense and the prosecution are now much more on an even keel. And police officers are finally going to have to be able to testify, and that the code is going to be much more of a Western and European and American style code. What is the feeling in Armenia with respect to the efficiency of that, and is it going to work to help get rid of some of the corruption?
Օրենքով հավասար են, փաստաբանը դատախազը հավասար են դատարանին, բայց դժբախտաբար փաստաբանի ասացները չի անցնում, այսինքն դատարանը ընդհանրապես դատախազության կցորդն է, այսինքն մեղադրանքը գրեթե դատարանում չի փոխվում, փաստաբան ինչքան էլ փորձում է, ինչքան էլ փաստարկներ է բերում, դրա համար շատ գործեր հասնում են Հայաստանից դուրս գնում են եվրոպական դատարան.
Both
sides, both parties are technically equal before the law, but the defense is usually not heard. They just don't carry quite as much weight, and the court is largely an extension of the prosecution, and that's why a lot of our cases end up going to European forums.
Let me follow up. The criminal code is supposed to be recently ratified to change that. Is there optimism among the people that there's going to be more equality in the courts for both defendants coming in?
Yes. Քան մեծ հույսեր չունեմ, որ բանկը փոխվի, որտեղ նորից օրինակ են բերում, մենք փայլուն ընտրական օրենսգիր ունեինք, հույս ունեինք, որ նորմալ ընտրություններ պետք է բերի, ինչ-որ բաներ փոխվում են պաստաբանների հետ, պաստաբաններ, ամենաշատ մենք աշխատում ենք պաստաբանների հետ, իրանք էլ ընդհատվում են, բայց ինչ-որ բաներ փոխվում են, ընդ որում իրանք դիմում են լրատվամիջոցներին, հասարակական կարծիքը ուզում են, որ շնշում գործադրի ու դեպքեր եղավ, երբ որ փաստաբանները իրոքնեն շնորհակալություն էին հայտնում, որտեղ կարողացան մեծ հասարակական շնշում գործադրել իշխանությունների վրա և նահանջեցին. Այդպիսի դեպքը օրինակ հիշենք բանը, Նարեկ Հարությունյանի ձերբակալությունից հետո փաստաբանների հետ շատ լավ լրատվամիջոցներ աշխատեցին և շատ կարճ ժամանակում նրանց նորից ազատ արձակեց. Շատ քիչ է, հասկան, դանդաղ, շատ դանդաղ է, դժվախտաբար շատ դանդաղ է ամեն ինչ Հայաստանում ընդհանուր։ Բաներ կան, որ կարելի է մի օրվա մեջ որոշում կայացնել և հակել այդ հարցը, բայց իշխանությունները քաղաքական կամք չունեն փոխելու ինչ-որ բան երկրում։
I'm not too hopeful. As I said earlier, we have great laws. The best example is the elections. There's just not the political will to implement them. And there's one thing that's happening right now, though, in general. We work well with the lawyers, the defense lawyers, and they've learned to come to us to help generate public pressure, develop public opinion, so that they can counter the prosecutorial side. And the best example of that, a recent example, is the case of Nadek Trunyan, who shortly after his arrest, we worked together, and because of public pressure, he was released fairly quickly. And the thing is that everything that's happening, all the changes that are happening are going at a very slow pace, even though there are some things that could be changed in a day.
Okay, next question. Yes, Edik.
Edik, sort of referencing directly by the laws probably that subject you to law, could you inform us a little bit about those Armenians?
Զրպարտությունը լավ, զրպարտությունը առաջ քրեական անցագործություն է համարվում, մեկ ու կես տարի առաջ դարձավ քաղաքացիական, ասենքն տուգանք դարձավ, առաջ կաբանդ նետ էին, քրիական էր, բայց որոշ պաշտոնյանների մասով դա մնացել է, ասենք դատախազ, դատավոր, ոստիկան, այդ մասով մնացել է, ասենք են դու նրանց եթե զրպարտում ես, քո վրա քրիական գործ կարող են հարուցել։ Հիմա մեր նկատմամբ այդպիսի մի գործ կա, որտեղ մեզ անդհատ հարցակնում է, մի երկու բառով պատմեմ այդ գործը, հա, երևի որ հասկանալի լինի։
So two points, and then he's going to give an example. I'll pass the mic back. A change that has occurred relatively recently is that previously libel was a criminal offense. Now it's civil, except if the object of the libel is a prosecutor, judge, or police, and we're actually involved in such a case right now.
Ռումինացիների մի խումբ եկան Հայաստան և քարտերի միջոցով գողություն արեցին բանկոմատներից։ Դրանց բոսերից մեկին բռնել էին, բայց հետո բաց թողեցին։ Մենք ցույց էինք տալիս, գրում էինք, թե ինչու բաց թողեցին և գրում էինք, թե դատավորը, դատախազը ինչպես են կաշարկվեց դրանցից։ Մեծ պատմություն էր սա, որովհետև հետո այդ տղան, որ գնաց ամբուլայ մեր ապրում, մեզ նամակ գրեց եվ որմեց ինքը ոնց էր ազատվել։ Անընդհատ շատ մեծ պատմությունը, դա մի տարի տևեց, ասինքն խումբը վրնվել էր խումբի անդամների հետ առանձին, երկար աշխատում էինք մինչև կարողացան խոսացնել, թե ոնց են իրենցից մեկը իրենց փոսին ազատել, եւ վերջը պատմեցին, որ կաշարքեն դրել։ Դա ամբողջ պատմությունը գրեցին ու ինչքան էին կաշարք դրել, եւ մեզ քրեական գործ հարուցեցին, մեզ սկսեցին հարցակցել, մինչև հիմա այդ պատմության մեջ ենք։
There was an instance of a Romanian operation, Romanians from England, and they were able to steal some $300,000 from ATMs. And it took us a year to report on this, and one of the main source was that after they were caught and ultimately released, went back to England, they actually wrote that they had gotten off through bribery. And when we reported on this whole thing after a year's worth of information gathering, we ended up being sued or taken to court for bribery.
Դրանից մեկ, դրանց մի խումբը բանտերում էր, մենք կարողանում էինք, տարիներով կարողանում էինք մտնել բանտեր, դրանից հետո երկու տարի է, մեզ արգելեցին, ընդհանրապես չեն կարողանում բանտ մտնենք հիմա։
As a consequence of this case, we're no longer allowed the last 2 years to go into the jails, because some of these guys were in the jails and we went in and we'd spoken to them, but as an upshot of this, we can no longer go into the jails.
I'm going to move on. I'm going to exercise executive privilege here because we're running out of time. Other questions? Yes. Yes, you.
Thank you all of you for your excellent presentations today. This question is directed to Ursula. Is there any hope of stopping the copper mining, in your opinion, or are we headed to a complete ecological disaster?
Thank you for the question. That is a tough one. You know, as an activist, as someone who deals with these issues pretty much on a daily basis, it can get depressing, and it's easy to get pessimistic and say, you know, it seems like it's turning from a pockmarked situation of just having a mine here and there to really the entire country seems to be being mined. I am hopeful, and that's my personal opinion. I think that Tehu seems to be the case that, you know, is now making people pay attention. There have been many mines in the past, and actually, I'm sorry, I didn't really explain it properly. The photos I was showing with the tailings, which is what's left over after the extraction, being dumped into that river, that's already happening. We have a copper smelting plant in Panela Verde, we have various mines throughout the country. So, you know, this is not new, but it is, you know, we have disappearing forests. It's kind of a combination of issues. We have, you know, disappearing forests. This forest in particular is old growth, which I mentioned is impossible to replace, home to hundreds of species of animals and plants. So people are paying attention, and the activists really have taken this up as, you know, the mining cause, basically. We have Kajaran, we have many others. But if this one case can go in a positive direction, at the very least forcing the company doing the mining to adhere to its own, to Armenia's own national environmental impact assessment laws, and, you know, enforcing the outcome, if we can even find the outcome that they have so far, you know, if we can make that happen, I am hopeful that we can clean this business up. It's never a clean business, but you can certainly improve it. And if you really do have a strong EIA process in place, some of these projects just they won't move forward in the future. I've been told to explain old growth. Sorry. And I do tend to use some terms. I'm sorry. Old growth, I think I did touch on this in my presentation, but it's basically a forest that has been growing for thousands of years. In most cases, it's thousands of years. It's an established forest, which means it supports ecosystems that you cannot replace. Even if you move, I think I heard Valix representative say something about, you know, we're going to uproot some of these great trees, and we're going to relocate these animals, and we're going to keep it intact. That's impossible. I mean, that's flat out impossible. Even if you take the animals and relocate them and replant, and, you know, you're going to, first of all, the animals will, I don't know if maybe Gary wants to explain it further, but basically the soil and the established forest keep the water intact, it keeps the food that grows there, and people can also use these resources, as I discussed a little bit. You can actually exploit that agroforestry. There are other options that you can actually take what grows there without destroying it. So if you clear cut old growth forest, you absolutely cannot replace it. And that's what makes this case particularly special.
Okay, moving right along. Other questions? We've got about 10 minutes, so we're going to speed it up. Yes, sir.
Yeah, so I have a quick statement and a few questions. One is, Turkey attacks Armenia and one bomb dropped in Armenia tomorrow. The diaspora will be up in arms and said, you know, Armenia is being attacked. But what's happening today in Armenia with the environmental change that's happening, the absolute usurpation of people's power is a larger issue. The immigration is a larger issue right now. So my question to the panel is, one, how do we coordinate the exposure of the bad actors? And I just will throw that one term on bad actors, many, many bad actors. So one is the exposure of those people. Secondly, how do we sustain the pressure on those people? Because these are human beings. These are individuals. There's not very many of them. And then finally, how do we, what does the panel think the diaspora could do to bring the coalition of these healthy forces? Because I see a lot of activity here with Pink, with Devil Movement, the Environmental Movement, Save Our City Movement. It seems that there's a lot of activists and activity, but not a coalition of healthy forces. And the final question is, with diaspora, the engagement, how do we, you know, what would the panel recommend from the standpoint of getting the diaspora to wake up? Because what I'm seeing is kind of dangerous, kind of a life or death thing. And all of us have traveled all those, the border regions and seeing the depopulation of Armenia. And the final comment that I'll make is, it would be pure chauvinism on our part to say that we want those lands, but nobody's living there. Because land is whoever that lives on. It's their property. From the standpoint of that, I would like to ask the panel.
Okay. Would anyone like to take a crack at it?
Եթե նախորդ հարցումին պատասխանեի, թե ուտից հույս կա թե չէ, ես էլ ասեի.
Just to, going back to the previous question for a second.
Չէ, եթե ես պատասխանեի, Սուլայի փոխարեն, թե ասեի, եթե Armenian Bar Association-ը միանա, հնարավորականացնենք.
If the Armenian Bar Association joins us, we can stop it.
Ընդհանրապես հայերը միշտ պայքարը ուզում են լինի, բայց իրանք չմասնակցեն դրան։
Armenians, it seems, always want to see the efforts, the struggles, the battles going on, but to sit on the sidelines while it's going on.
Նայեք, Թեղուտի մասին, երբ որ կառավարության որոշումը եղավ 2001 թվականին, մենք սկսեցինք գրել։ Այդ ժամանակ մենք գիտեինք վտանգը ինչա, բայց դժբախտաբար էկոլոգներ չկային։ Այսինքն մենք պաշտպաններ չունենք, եթե հետքը նայեք, կտեսնեք, երբ ենք սկսել գրել դրա մասին։
Back in 2001, when the government first made the decision about allowing mining in Tevut, we at Hetq started to write about it. You can go back and see that. But unfortunately, at the time, we didn't have environmental activists to take up that cause.
Հիմա Թեղուտում անտառները հատում են, մի արդեն մոտ 100 հեկտար անտառ հատել են, նոր սկսել ենք մտածել Թեղուտի մասին։
About 100 hectares of Tevut have already been chopped down, and it's only now that we're starting to think about that.
But it's not like that. սվարանցում եւ Աբովյանում հսկայական տարածքներ են լինելու, հսկայական տարածքներ։ Ես պարբերաբար քոնե գրում եմ ամիսը 1, երբ ամիսը 1 գրում եմ, բայց նորից ոչ ոք չի կանգնում, ասիկա երբ որ աշխատանքները սկսեն, նորեն ժամանակ հայտնվելու են մարդիկ, ասեն ես ինչ եղավ։ Դրա համար պետք է ամեն ինչ ժամանակին անել։
You've got to deal with these issues in a timely fashion. Right now there's a Chinese company that's gotten the rights to engage in mining in 3 locations, Abogyan, Svarans, and I missed the third one, in Hrastan. And I'm writing about these, I write about them monthly, maybe bi-monthly, but no one's responding, nobody's taking up that cause. We have to address these issues in a timely and prompt fashion.
Գործարարները մոտ 50 միլիոն են ներդրել։ Եթե Տաթևի այդ հանքավայրը աշխատի, այդ իրանց ամբողջ ներդրումը կորչելու է։ Նույնիսկ նրանք չեն ուզում պայքարել։
In Tathev, investors have put in 50 million, and if the mine in that area starts to operate, they'll lose their investment. And yet, they're not even willing to engage in trying to stop this mine.
Ես կարծում եմ Տաթևի մասին գրելուց ես նույնիսկ Սփյուռքին ակնարկել եմ, ոչ մի արձագանք չեմ ստացել, որ Սփյուռքը, ոչ Սփյուռքը սիրում է բան, եկեղեցիներ, որ գալիս են տուրիստական խմբերով գնալ եկեղեցիներ, ես ասում եի խաղացնեմ Սփյուռքի այդ մասը, գուցե ձեն հանեմ, բայց Սփյուռքը ձեն չի անում, Սփյուռքն էլ էկոլոգիական կարևորություն չի տալիս Հայաստանի խնդիրներին, չգիտեմ ինչի, իսկապես ճիշտ օրինակ բերեց, եթե վաղը Թուրքիա միրուն գցի, ամբողջ Սփյուռքը ոտքի կանգնի, ամբողջ Սփյուռքը այսօր էլ, ամբողջ Սփյուռքը բանով է, ցեղասպանության խնդրով է զբաղվում, բայց ցեղասպանության նման նույն խնդիրներն են սրանք, տարբերություն իսկապես չկա։
Regarding the Dotted example, I even thought I'd try to catch the diaspora's attention by pointing out the church angle, the historic value there, that seems to be of great interest to people in the diaspora, but even that hasn't elicited a reaction, and it's really true that the response that would come from the diaspora if a bomb from Turkey landed in Armenia, and yet these are indeed just as critical issues for us.
I'm just going to quickly add 2 cents here. I agree with most of what you say, Al, and I think the diaspora needs to rethink its role vis-a-vis Armenia. We need to be more proactive and we have to be more fearless. I think in the early years post-independence, there was a certain reluctance in the diaspora to disagree with Armenia. But I think now we're coming to the realization that there are many Armenians. You know, there's the Armenia of the oligarchs, there's the Armenia of the ruling authorities, and then there's the Armenia of these social movements that often represent the dispossessed. I think there's a tremendous amount of input that could come from the diaspora, and not only in the form of money, which used to be sort of the immediate answers, send us money, but now I think these activists are thirsting for other kinds of input, expertise, I think in this case I would say legal expertise, but also experienced activists who've done work in the environmental realm or women's issues. A lot of these emerging activists now are open. They learn from other countries, they learn from other environments, and they want our input. So I think right now we're in the process of redefining our culture here, and I think there need to be a lot more panels like this. You know, I don't believe issues get solved through lectures, but lectures are a good starting point to inform and enlighten them. And there need to be more conferences and more panels like this, and I expect there will be very soon. I'm hopeful this fall there will be a series of panels and conferences devoted to social movements in Armenia. Okay, let's take a couple more and then we've got to close up. Yes, Mr. Kishishian.
I'd like to thank Edik for being so nice. One of my articles was completed on Ed. 14,000 kids to read Hetq. So anybody who wants to really know what's going on in Armenia should really check Hetq. But you think this panel, if this panel talks to the government, does it make any change by the principle? Foreign governments that would be a lot of money for Armenia, would they be pressuring the government to change?
have a very quick comment to answer that. I mean, that's a very big topic, but one of the reasons that I mentioned that 90% of the copper mined in 2007 went to Germany is exactly because we've been looking into how can we pressure we've also been looking into partnering with international organizations and how can we form a campaign that is international in scope and getting non-Armenian actors involved, but also pressuring companies who are involved in some of these contracts. They're involved and they need to know that they're involved, and I think that is something that needs to be further explored. We're exploring that right now.
I just wanted to just echo a couple of the things that Al said. I think not only should we be more fearless in challenging members of the Armenian government as it relates to issues. For example, I don't know if you noticed, but I put the email addresses up of the parliament members who had spoken out with the equivalent of hate speech against the LGBT community. All of that is public information. There's nothing stopping this whole audience to right now on your phones, write an email, you know, say I'm in a conference, this is what's being talked about, and by the way, your picture was up and I hear that this is what your opinion is. That takes no effort whatsoever, number one. Number two, I think we should also be fearless in calling out our own diaspora organizations in terms of how they are dealing with Armenia. I feel that whereas this audience may be farther ahead in the willingness to be fearless and to call out these issues, I think that perhaps our organizations, for some reasons that we may understand because there are investors, etc., are a little slower to get there. And so I think that it's true that a lot of our good friends run these organizations, but I do think that we should be more fearless in calling out our own organizations in terms of their unwillingness to stand up on these issues.
Եթե ձեզ թվում է, որ Հայաստանի վրա ճնշում չեն գործադրում, դուք սխալվում եք. Հայաստանի վրա բոլոր երկրները ճնշում են գործադրում.
If you think that there are no pressures applied to Armenia, you're very wrong. But that pressure is applied in that country's interest.
Մեկը Թուրքիայի հետ համաձայնագիր ստորագրել, մեկը իրենց երկրների պրոյեկտներ անել. Նայեք, Գերմանիա, մեր հունք արտահանում է մեծ մասը Գերմանիա, Մեծ Բրիտանիա, իրականում այդ գերմանական ընկերությունները Հայաստանում նաև էկոլոգիական պրոյեկտներ են անում. Այսինքն իրանք մեր հունքը տանում են, Հայաստանը իրենց համար գաղութ է, ինչքան հնարավոր է պետք է տանեն այդ հունքը. Հետո կգա մի քիչ գրանտային ծրագրեր կանեն.
The pressures to sign agreements with Turkey are pressures, or the pressures that are applied so that country X's particular company gets a contract, these all go on. And what's going on is that a lot of the raw materials that are exported from Armenia, the stuff that's mined, go to Germany and Great Britain. And put simply, we're just really a colony to them so that they can be more environmentally sound, but at our
expense.
We're the ones who have to struggle on this front. We have to create the pressure in Armenia. We should not be relying on other countries.
Okay. I have to exercise my executive privilege that I have. Thank you, Andrani, moderating this fascinating panel. Thank you to the panelists. Please give them a round of applause. One thing I wanted to mention to Edik, because of the time limitations, as you see, we're already behind. I cut my chairman's report a little short this morning, and I totally lost my page on Tevut and what Armenian Bar thinks and what Armenian Bar is doing. I just wanted you and the audience to know that we are part of a group to do another one of our open letters to the president, along with the ATP, Armenian Tree Project, AEN, and our board has voted to approve our signature, and I'm happy to report, and it makes us very happy, that the Armenian Medical Association, the doctors have also, their board voted to approve that letter, calling at a bare minimum for a fair and balanced environmental impact study and more to be done by the Republic of Armenia. And we are expecting AHPO, the East Coast counterpart of the Medical Association, to put it on their agenda as well, and they'll be voting very soon, and then we should be able to release the letter, hopefully sooner rather than later. And at some point, you know, yes, these panels are great, but of course we need to, you know, stop talking and start walking and start acting, and I think that's what they called for. Again, many, many thanks, and you should know, at least at the leadership level, I think, of our Armenian bar, we do know. We abide by the maxim that sometimes neutrality does not help the victim, it only helps the oppressor. We're very aware of that, and we will act as much as we can. I would like to present a small token of our appreciation. Usually we give, you know, mugs and stuff to our lecturers, but we thought, let's be original and be consistent, and we got these plaques. But what is going, along with ATP, who have helped us with this, and Armenian Bar Association, and I will start, I'll read what we're giving to Andranik, since he is the moderator, the chief, and the same plaque will be given to all. Unfortunately, I don't have one for Karen, who's done a superb job interpreting that. Says, for Armenia's future, wherever a tree grows, there grows hope. Whoever plants believes in tomorrow. Diana Der Hovhannisyan, and there's an Armenian version on it on the right side. It says, in honor of Andranik Kasbarian and in appreciation of his participation in the Armenian Bar Association's 23rd annual meeting in Glendale, California on May 19, 2012. A cluster of four trees has been planted in the shadows of Mount Ararat to help fulfill the promise and potential of Armenia. Armenia Tree Project, Armenian Bar Association. Thank you very much. Quickly present it to the other panelists.